Hello and welcome to this week's episode of Geek-Minded Fools. My name's Graham.
And I'm Scott.
We'll start off this week's episode with another visit to the monkey farm.
Hey, partners, it's time to see what Scott's doing down on his monkey farm.
However...
No!
I'm sorry, Scott.
You shit. It's my monkey farm.
I'm hijacking the monkey farm.
I'm running this monkey farm now. This is my thing. It was my thing. It was my one little thing, and you've hijacked
it. I'm sorry.
I've not had it long.
But, obviously, comics is my thing.
It is.
And there's been some big comic news of late. So, we're going to start with the internet furore that has risen over DC's decision to withdraw a variant Joker cover for Batgirl issue 41.
Comic stuff I know about.
Yay. And then moving on to Secret Wars, in which Marvel's decision not to publish many of their ongoing titles in their June solicitations has led to rumours that perhaps they're looking at completely rebooting the Marvel Universe in the same way DC did with their DC New 52 back in 2011 after Secret Wars has ended. And finally, something that's related to Secret Wars but gets a separate mention because it's something that's very close to my heart is the announcement of the title The Amazing Spider-Man Renew Your Vows. So.
Exciting stuff. And that was the monkey farm for this week. Less for the bull, kid. You get the horns.
Scott. The Joker.
Yeah.
Now, what DC have been doing recently is every month they have a theme of variant covers that they put out for each of their titles. So we've had Harley Quinn month, we've had Selfie month.
Every month is Harley Quinn month for me.
We've had a movie poster month whereby they bring out variant covers that are based on famous movie posters. And June, as it's the 75th anniversary of the Joker, they are having a Joker variant cover month, and there has been a bit of a backlash over DC's decision to withdraw one of the covers, and it was the variant cover to Batgirl issue 41, which was basically drawn as an homage to The Killing Joke, written by Alan Moore and drawn by Brian Bolland. The Joker shoots Barbara Gordon, Batgirl, and paralyzes her, and it was after that that she ended up in a wheelchair and therefore became Oracle for many years. And of course, with the New 52 reboot a few years back, Batgirl Barbara Gordon is not in a wheelchair and he's back as normal. However, the artist, who is
Hot Dog Jumping Frog Raphael Albuquerque, I think that's how you pronounce it.
He drew an homage to that, which shows the Joker mocking up a gun with his finger and pointing it at Barbara.
With a gun and in the other hand draped over her shoulder. Yeah.
As she looks absolutely terrified, has her face painted white and the red large smile on her lips.
It's a fucking brilliant
It is a
cover.
Fantastic piece of art. It is dark, it is menacing, it is truly frightening. However, there were complaints about it due to the fact that following the reboot, Batgirl is seen as being maybe not a younger audience, but certainly a more audience-friendly character than maybe some of the other DC titles. And also, DC have very much retconned the whole Killing Joke storyline out of the comics, and so many of the new readers won't actually understand the reference or the homage. So, due to the various complaints they had, DC decided to pull it. They have pulled what is a fantastic piece of art due to internet whingers saying we don't like this, we don't think that it's appropriate. Scott, what do you think?
For me, mate, as I've already stated, I think the artwork itself is just phenomenally good. It is a beautiful front cover. I do agree a little bit with the fact that you cannot be shielded from what you see on a cover because it's going to be, you know, customer facing straight away. You know, you can't choose not to look at that because it's going to be there. Unless, of course, they have it in a foil wrap or whatever they do with special things of that type.
Which they don't do
with comics, do they?
Because the cover is your shop window.
It's your shop window, yeah, indeed. Now, I believe the cover was pulled, actually, at the request of the artist, wasn't it, in the end? Which kind of makes him almost Kubrick-esque, doesn't it?
You do wonder, did he jump or was he pushed?
Yeah.
You know, regardless of who pulled it, it was due to complaints from a minority of internet users. And now, of course, the backlash is coming where people are saying, why on earth are we censoring in this way?
Yeah.
Now, one thing you have to realise is that the Joker is an evil psychopath.
Yep.
He is a complete nut job. And therefore, to me, this cover, more than an awful lot I've seen recently, represents the Joker, represents yeah. what he stands for, and is an outstanding homage to what is a classic story. But Batman comics, going back, you know, for the last 3-4 years, have shown Joker having had his face cut off, has been wearing it as a mask.
You can buy a box set with the aforementioned removed facial skin as like an add-on in the box, can't you?
And so you're saying that an evil psychopath wearing his own removed face as a mask, literally pinned on and put on with a bit of
elastic
band, that's fine. I don't know if it's from a victim point of view, because
I think
Gordon clearly looks absolutely terrified.
In peril.
She's looking almost at the audience with a look of peril in her eyes. Now, what we will do is we will put a picture of this up on the Facebook page.
Yes, indeed we will.
So that people can see that and you can make your own minds up. But one thing I really want to show you, Scott.
Show me.
Is a slight change that a member of the public made to the picture that gives it a completely different spin. Have a look at this and tell me how much you think that changes the overall impression of the picture.
Well, I think not a great deal. I mean, it's a real kind of blink and you'll miss it moment,
well,
isn't it? I mean,
but
it does very much change the tone of the image, doesn't it?
All they've done is change the eyes so that instead of the eyes looking straightforward scared...
This is Barbara's eyes,
yes,
obviously.
She is looking angrily at the Joker, and it immediately changes her from a victim to somebody who's not prepared to take this. The first picture, she does look like a terrified victim. The second one, she looks like somebody who's pissed off at what this guy's doing to her.
It's amazing how much a small little change
Absolutely.
Like that can completely and utterly change the tone of an image.
Yeah.
I mean, personally, I think the artist, as you say, did he jump or was he pushed? I don't think they should have pulled it. I think they should have left it as is. I think it's a perfectly serviceable piece of art, and I think it, as you said at the top of this, it really sums up the Joker's character.
Yeah. My only question is, what are the other variant covers going to be like? Is it going to be Joker and the character from whichever comic the variant cover is of lacing daisies into each other's hair, skipping happily through a meadow together? The guy's a fucking psychopath.
Indeed,
you need to show him being a psychopath, being scary. The whole point of Joker is everybody's terrified of him because you don't know what he's going to do.
The first thing I thought about when I read about this story initially was, believe it or not, Saw 2, the movie Saw 2.
Oh, right.
When that was first released in the UK, the poster was two severed fingers to kind of show the Saw 2. And they refused to let it go out because they said it was too graphic.
Mm.
I didn't really find it that graphic. The fingers weren't covered in blood. It was a great way to push the film. I think this was a great way to push the art
of this is anything that's graphic about it. It is simply that Barbara looks terrified. It looks like she is a victim.
It's putting a female in a position of peril.
Yes.
She's clearly fearful. You can see on her face.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what he does.
Exactly.
That's what the Joker does.
Exactly.
I mean, anyone who is initiated with you know, any of the Bat and the Joker stories, you know, we know, unfortunately, what happened to Barbara Gordon. We know she ends up being, I nearly called her C-Fax then, Oracle.
Hey.
For me, storm in a teacup, I think.
I think it's a shame.
It is a shame, because it's censorship for censorship's sake.
I just think it is the vocal minority once again winning on the internet because they don't like something. To me, it was a perfect representation, not only of the Joker, but of his previous relationship with Barbara.
Indeed.
Batgirl. Okay, the second one in my monkey farm is...
And that's it for the monkey farm again this week.
Secret Wars. Now, I've spoken previously about the Secret Wars comic series that's coming out in May.
Not far off.
No. It seems like Marvel aren't pulling any punches on it. They have not solicited, i.e. announced for publication, an awful lot of their titles for June. Secret Wars kicks off in May, and it seems like while they're publishing it, there's going to be no ongoing titles. The only thing going on is going to be Secret Wars and its peripheral titles. And therefore, rumours are abound that Marvel are going to do a complete reboot. Obviously, Secret Wars has been sold on the fact that the Marvel Universe and the Ultimate Universe, which is this sort of variation of the Marvel Universe with slightly different versions of the usual Marvel characters, those are both going to be ending, and the only thing existing will be the battle world on which all these characters are fighting it out. Hence all the spin-off titles. So yeah, Marvel potentially doing a DC-like reboot and starting everything again. Now, bearing in mind that an awful lot of titles that are out there are still in quite low numbers. I mean, Spider-Man is only just hitting, what, 17, 18? You know, you've got an awful lot of titles that have just started. You know, Hawkeye, Howard the Duck, new titles are starting all the time.
I thought that was a new character in Hawkeye, Howard the Duck. That would be awesome.
Is now the time for Marvel to start again? Obviously, at this point, it is only rumour.
They've just announced as well, haven't they, Captain Britain and the Mighty Defenders joining the Secret Wars. They've got some other story arc going out at the same time as well, as Secret Wars, apparently. So I read briefly the other day.
Okay.
I mean, you know a lot more about this than I do, obviously. I think it's the Hail Hydra thing that's going out at the same time as Secret Wars. What's have you got a worry here about Secret Wars?
No, I'm looking forward to Secret Wars. As I say, I was a big fan of the first one, and I've been looking forward to this one.
Mm.
I'm just not sure whether Marvel needs to reboot. I mean, the thing is, of course, that
it's a fashionable thing.
Yeah, I mean, Captain America, for those who don't know, Steve Rogers, Captain America, lost his super soldier serum and is turned into an old man. Hence why Sam Wilson, the Falcon, is now the new Captain America. Thor lost the mantle of being the God of Thunder, and that's been taken up by a female. Now, I don't really know too much of the background of that because I don't read Thor. There's been an awful lot changing within comics, and maybe this is the time for them to wipe the slate clean. But so much good stuff has started recently, and it just seems like, you know, do you need to be retconning a title that's only issue 4 or issue 8 or issue 12? You know, you've got the feeling that it's an itch that they wanted to scratch, being that DC have done it and been so successful.
DC with the new 52.
Absolutely. But they completely changed an awful lot of their characters. You know, Superman's costume, you know, some of the origins, an awful lot changed. And of course, it would be the perfect way to bring Wolverine back, because Wolverine was killed off in the Death of Wolverine title last year. So it is a way of bringing him back. So I don't know if they've deliberately set up all these things because they know that they can knock it all down and just start building from scratch. But
all I care about with Secret Wars is there going to be another series of toys, you know, to match the original run?
Well, funnily enough, one thing that I am looking forward to is, you know, I was telling you about the Star Wars action figure variants.
Yes, indeed.
Well,
the front cover, yeah.
Each of the main Secret Wars titles will have an action figure variant, which is basically the figures, but on the old Secret Wars blister packs.
Nice.
Which do look fantastic. I mean, Secret Wars issue 1 is Spider-Man. There's also a Deadpool one that looks quite cool.
Your favourite.
Yes. There's, I think issue 2 is Mr. Fantastic with his sort of elongated arm, that sort of thing. So those would be quite cool from a collector's point of view, getting those. I've actually ordered those in many of the titles rather than the regular cover.
Yeah.
Because I really do like those. But
was there an animated version of Secret Wars as well? Or have I made that up in my head?
I don't believe so. I certainly don't. I mean, you might have had something like that happening in one of the normal animated series, like, you know, maybe
like
sort
a
of
two episode thing,
sort of the Spider-Man cartoon or something, but I certainly don't remember a Secret Wars cartoon.
But I suppose only time's going to tell with the Secret Wars thing. I mean,
yeah,
to reboot or not to reboot.
Yeah, and certainly the way that they've been teeing things up with changes to Wolverine, Captain America, Thor, it maybe does suggest that something like that is on the cards, or at least a complete reshuffle. But I'm kind of hoping that they don't restart back to issue ones, because when you launch everything with issue one, you get 37 different variant covers, and it just leads to more of an expense. And the trouble is, if you keep starting things again and again and again, I mean, people always say that a number one is a great jumping on point, but, you know, do you really need 3 jumping on points in the space of 2 years for the same title? It just seems like something that they're doing because they want to be up there with DC and actually generate some interest from that.
Yeah. Does it feel now that DC and Marvel have become more business-minded than perhaps they've been in the past?
They've always been business-minded.
Well, I imagine they have, but do you think now a younger group of talent in there, maybe in the head offices and the back offices rather than the artists and the writers, have jumped on to you know, fully franchise the fuck out of everything?
I don't necessarily think that's the case. What I think is that they're very aware that their audience is getting older. The average age of a comic buyer is probably
19.
Closer to 40 than it is to 20. It's people like me who started collecting in the 70s, 80s, who've grown up with it. And the trouble is with kids these days, there's so much out there. If you can spend $4 on a comic every month, or you can buy $50 on a video game that will give you 80 hours of gameplay, what are you going to do? And I just think there's far more options out there. And I think what they're trying to do is constantly generate interest to get new people excited about comics and involved in comics.
I think going, you know, just adding on to what you've just said there, that the main thing about comics and video games and movies, you know, across all mediums for younger kids today is that they're just much more readily available.
Yeah.
I mean, for us, you know, when we were in our teens, it would mean a hike to the nearest comic store or, you know... Kids can just, you know, either read them online or order online now, can't they? So, I mean,
it's all online.
Oh, they just don't know they're born, do they?
They're born these days.
Oh, you needy little shit. Fuck your news. I'm out of here.
But yes, so time will tell on that one. We shall see whether it does lead to a major reboot. But yeah, it will be interesting. But I'm certainly going to enjoy Secret Wars as it goes on anyway. And then final piece of news in this week's Monkey Farm is Spider-Man. Now, The Amazing Spider-Man Renew Your Vows is a title that has been solicited for a June release, written by usual Spider-Man writer Dan Slott and with art by Adam Kubert. And effectively, it's retconning what they retconned, which is when I walked away from Spider-Man back in 2008 because of the One More Day when back in 1986, '87. Peter married Mary Jane and they lived sometimes happily, sometimes not so happily as a married couple. And at one point even had Mary Jane was pregnant and then the child was stolen supposedly by a nurse working for Norman Osborn. And that was kind of retconned out so that didn't really happen.
That was during the Clone Saga thing, wasn't it? That all went out.
And then back in 2008, Joe Quesada decided that he didn't want them to be married anymore and they had this story One More Day whereby, in order to save Aunt May's life, Peter made an agreement with Mephisto, who's the Marvel's version of the devil.
Not Bono from U2. No.
That in order to save Aunt May's life, he would make it so that he and Mary Jane were never married and immediately... bang, they sort of went back and the relationship had happened but they'd never been married and so they'd split up and moved on.
I remember that crushing you.
It did, because, you know, I'd had 20 plus years of these two being, you know, the vast majority of my Spider-Man collecting, they'd been married. And it wasn't just me, there was an awful lot of people who were upset by this. I mean, I was...
This was on BBC News, it was everywhere, wasn't it? It was a big thing.
I was so peed off that I walked away from Spider-Man comics for a while. You know, it didn't feel like it was my Spider-Man. But, spinning out of Secret Wars, when obviously all bets are off, this title, Spider-Man Renew Your Vows, sees Peter and Mary Jane very happily married and with a young daughter, who I would imagine is called May, because that was what she was due to be called in the comics. If I can just read you what Dan Slott has said. He said, Spidey's been around for over 50 years. For close to half that time, he was married to Mary Jane. As someone who came into the book right after the marriage was written out, I can tell you there's an extremely vocal section of our readership who were, and are to this day, very passionate on this subject. And that right there is probably one of the single biggest understatement I've ever said during a Spider-Man interview. As a Spidey writer, the Spider marriage has been locked off part of the Spidey-U toy box. It's taken something as big as Secret Wars, an event where every rule can be broken, where nothing is off limits. It's taken something this epic to give me the freedom to go to the powers that be and ask, can we bust the lock? And so I will have to say, now I don't know how long this is going to be going on for. I don't know if it's going to be a one-issue thing or, you know, this could be something that with a reboot they're going to carry forward. But I am just excited to see it. It kind of feels like something that, as you say, not even that, but something that really did disappoint me. Not necessarily hurt me, because let's face it, it's only comics. You know, we all have to have a sense of perspective with this.
Yeah, and you've still got all the original work that was, you know, the body of work that was there before involving the character.
But when there's something that you're passionate about and you love and you've invested time and money in it, when something kind of rips the heart out of it, which is what it felt at the time, you know, I was a bit disappointed, you know, and saddened by it, you know, that they'd taken that decision. And I just think, to go back to this, I can't wait. I'm hugely, hugely excited.
So that's a lovely thing, because, I mean, you are obviously, you know, a huge comic book geek, and you do get excited about things, but I like seeing you excited about your main boy, because to me Spidey is your main boy. He's your man. So it's nice to see them bringing him back. Let's see what happens.
Absolutely. And I will end with one thing, which is the last part of Dan Slott's interview said, "This is the Pete and MJ you knew and loved in the late 80s and early 90s of Amazing Spider-Man. Well, if they'd had a baby. And if Venom and all of Spidey's greatest enemies were..." Ah, sorry, got ahead of myself for a second. Just forget I said that.
Yeah.
Oh, Dan, you tease.
Oh, Danny boy. We like Dan Slott, didn't we?
We like him a lot.
You gave him shit, didn't you?
Absolutely fantastic.
You gave him shit. Is that the first Comic-Con we went to? And you gave him shit.
No, that was year two. That was 2013.
I can't remember what you said to him. You said something along the lines of, you've killed Peter Parker, or something along
no,
the...
No, no, no.
What did you say to him? No. It was a great moment. I just can't remember it.
I just said to him, "I know you're having fun having killed off Peter and having Doc Ock as Spider-Man."
Spoilers.
And then, as I was shaking his hand, I just tightened my grip ever so slightly and just said, "But bring him back soon, yeah?"
Yeah.
And of course, then walked away, and he went all pantomime villain, started saying, "He's dead. He's not coming back."
Yeah. He was very good, wasn't he?
He was lovely.
He was a nice guy. That is exciting news. I'm just looking now, actually, at the.
And I'm going to buy that for you as well, because I think you should read it.
I'm just looking at the Adam Kubert image of MJ, Peter, and what looks to be the daughter on Spidey's.
Yeah. And again, we shall put that up on the Facebook page.
And we can all, hopefully, at some stage in 2015, renew our vows.
Yes, indeed. Well, that's all for the Monkey Farm for this week. Again, I apologise, Scott, for having hijacked your Monkey Farm. There's the keys back.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
Back in the safe hands. And now we shall move on with this week's Quick Hits.
Quick Hits.
Right, me first this week. And I have a cracking little Blu-ray that I wanted to talk about. Which is Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Love it.
The movie. Now, I have a concern, and that is that to a generation out there now, people aren't going to know what Mystery Science Theater 3000 is, which is an absolute tragedy.
That's a terrible thing.
Yes. For those who don't know, back in the 90s, there was an American TV show called Mystery Science Theater 3000, and it was nothing more than a guy called Mike Nelson and his two robot friends.
His two sidekicks, if you like.
Yes, called Crow and Tom Servo, would sit there and watch old crap movies, like B-movies. And the setup was that they were in space on this spaceship, and in order to avoid the boredom, they would go and watch films and provide, not quite a commentary, but a voiceover to the films. You would actually see the film on the screen as if they're in a cinema, and you would see the three of them in silhouette sitting there. And as they were watching these dreadful, dreadful films, they would simply take the piss out of them and just do silly voices, adding little bits, and just turn what was a pretty funny thing due to it being a crap film anyway, but making it brilliantly, brilliantly hilarious.
Would you say probably the first instance of any sort of movie commentary?
Maybe so, yes.
Albeit a piss take.
Yeah, because it was certainly early 90s, wasn't it?
88, and therefore, it started
that early, did it? Okay, yeah. I mean, I can remember starting watching it in the early 90s. It was sort of a late night thing. It would be put on, I can't even remember what channel it was on, but it was shown late night. Then it sort of disappeared, and then it reappeared on the Sci-Fi channel when that started. And it's never really got the exposure over here that it deserved. I mean, so much so that you can't buy the series over here. You know, you can only buy American copies. And that's why I sort of wanted to mention the movie. Now,
was that purchased from a store just off the shelf over here in the UK, or was it bought online?
Bought that from Amazon.
Amazon. So Blu-ray is a region free anyway, aren't they?
But they're not all region free, are they? You do get American ones. You do get US region ones that don't play over here.
Oh, I didn't know that. Yes. I thought they were all just region free.
No, they still have regions. But no, this one's a region two. So it is one of ours rather than one of theirs. And the film they watch is a great old sci-fi classic called This Island Earth, which is a really dodgy 50s sci-fi film. The only thing I would say is a slight downside on this is because it's a movie, they keep pulling away from them watching the film. and go into these sort of other characters on the ship, one of which is this sort of mad professor type.
Dr. Forrester.
Yes, who hates them and he's trying to mess things up for them. And to me, that's a bit unnecessary. All I want is these guys sitting there and watching the movie.
Yeah.
And it is absolutely hilarious. It is brilliant. I mean, to take a very dodgy concept and have these guys doing a stupid voiceover commentary on it, I mean, it sounds very basic. And funny enough, when they stopped doing it, they're actually doing a podcast now where they record their own commentary tracks and you can play them along when you watch a film. So you can actually put them over films now, sort of, you know, recent films. But it was a brilliant TV show. I mean,
it ran for a fair few episodes as well. Yeah, it was like nigh on 200 episodes.
Yeah. You know, you're watching a bad film that would make you laugh anyway, but then with just such clever piss taking over it. And very much my sense here, I mean, you know that I'm a sarcastic person.
Yeah, no.
Who loves taking the piss out of myself and everything else. And this is just right up my street. And all I can say is, pick it up. I mean, you can probably get this for less than a tenner from Amazon. Mystery Science Theater 3000, the movie. And I guarantee you, you will be laughing out loud.
I'm pretty positive as well. And this is not something that I've just read. This is off my own. This is my own opinion. I'm pretty sure that you wouldn't have the character Bender in Futurama if it wasn't for the two robot sidekicks. In particular, Crow T Robot.
Yes.
I mean, he is just, well, geniusly written.
Mike sort of says silly things, but the two robots are the ones who have the great lines. The idea of literally them, and you see them in silhouette walking into the cinema and seeing that, it's almost like you're filming it from the back of the cinema. You just, and all the way through, you just see their silhouettes there.
Yeah.
Please do give it a go. If you take no notice of any of my quick hits, please give this one a go, and I guarantee you will not be disappointed.
I second that, yes, indeed.
Scott, what's yours?
This week, sir, I hope I'm not going to ramble on too long, because I've got a lot to talk about in my quick hit. My quick hit is a TV show from the mid-90s, and it was The Fabulous Brass Eye.
Ugh.
Now, there's a reason why I'm going to talk to you about Brass Eye today, and that's because it's almost as if Chris Morris, the creator, writer, star of Brass Eye, kind of had a little glimpse into the future and saw something that maybe we didn't see back in the mid-90s by brilliantly putting Neil Fox, or Dr. Fox, as they do point out that he's not an actual doctor, in their much maligned and much publicised paedophile special, which was brilliantly titled Pedageddon. I think it's only just timely to talk about it now, seeing I'm not a real Dr. Fox, there's now, well, looking at a bit of prison time, I think, possibly, well, is he not?
Allegations have been
made.
Yes,
of course. They are allegations. This. They are only allegations, but, you know, everyone is innocent until proven guilty.
Yeah.
I just found that an amazing thing, because, you know, you've got that amazing moment in the special with Neil Fox nailing a nail into a crab, but we'll go into that later on. Brass Eye was basically it was a parody current affairs show that ran for very, very short amount of episodes, 6 episodes and 1 special, which was the paedophile special. I feel so uncomfortable saying the word paedophile. I really, really do.
But of course, there was so much. I mean, it was front page news when they brought that out.
Oh, very much so, yeah.
Because there was an uproar about why are you taking such a serious subject and making humour out of it.
I mean, the initial show, as I say, ran for 6 episodes, which were animals, drugs, science, sex, crime and decline. During those 6 episodes, they managed to completely, in my eyes, annihilate people like Paul Daniels, Stephen Burkoff, Nicholas Parsons, Noel Edmonds, Bernard Manning, of course, Dr. Fox. There was a liberal smattering of
Wolf
from Gladiators as well. A liberal smattering of politicians also as well. Carla Lane, the writer of Bread, who was duped into believing an elephant and got its own trunk rammed in its
shut
anus.
Up his arse, yeah.
If you haven't ever been privy to Chris Morris's work, this is a great point to step in. I mean, it did come after his initial work, which was The Day
to
Day.
The Day to Day, yeah.
Now, which again, you know, a parody news show.
Yeah, but again, was something that was very much ahead of its time. Because, I mean, they were parodying news programmes, and yet you actually look at the way news is presented now, and it's pretty much like that. It was what he was saying 20-odd years ago. How crap would it be if our news was like this? And now it is.
There's a brilliant moment where they've got an infographic thing that comes up and it's just basically loads of sticks with Fox's heads on. And it just means nothing. And then the little voiceover bit that says, we know that fact times importance equals news. And that is the shit that you get on the news. Absolutely. You know, as beautifully shown in one of the Charlie Brooker shows a couple of weeks ago with the brilliantly named Emily Cernay.
Yes.
Who just did a brilliant parody of a news report.
Yeah.
But you know, you wouldn't have that unless you'd have had this. I mean, and it's the writers on board. You had
so it's a fake panorama type thing, isn't it? Whereby what they've done is they've had all these terrible so-called things that have happened, and they've got celebrities to lend their voices to it.
Yeah, so they're duping them into supporting, you know, fake charities or fake, just basically duping people.
But what they were doing was, I mean, they were sort of waving the fact that they were duping them in the celebrities' faces. Like, in the drugs episode, you had a drug called cake.
You did. Can you remember what area of the brain that cake affects?
No, I can't. Go on.
It was Shatner's bassoon.
Now, at one point, you got Noel Edmonds saying about the fact that cake isn't made from anything natural.
Yeah.
It has been completely manufactured. And therefore, at one point, Noel Edmonds says to camera, cake is a made-up drug.
Yeah. it's just brilliantly done. You know, another instance of that is Neil Fox saying, well, there's no actual proof for this, although it is a fact. No scientific proof, but it is a fact. Of course, Bernard Manning talking about cake in the drugs episode as well, explaining that one kiddie cried all the water out of his body. Imagine what that did to his mother. It's a fucking disgrace.
Now, who was the MP that they got him to record a great noise speech and then edit it together so he can say, you can no more get an elephant's chunk of his arse?
No, that was Nicholas Parsons. It was Nicholas Parsons. You had a particular MP whose name escapes me, though, who brilliantly in the paedophile episode, Peter Geddon, states that paedophiles are using an area of the internet the size of Ireland. But it's the delivery of these people. Just, you know, they ask because they're so wanting to have the attention.
Well, they're so earnest.
Yeah,
aren't they?
Yeah. You know, and they've just not bothered to check any of the facts. I mean, as you know, we spoke very, very briefly at the top of this about
Paul Levitz wouldn't have done that.
No, he wouldn't have. No, he'd have checked first. I mean, the special, which wasn't aired till 4 years after the initial show finished in the early 2000s, it garnered over 3,000 complaints.
Yes.
Now, I've watched this episode 100 times. It's of course the subject matter is going to be near the knuckle, yes, and you know, maybe unpalatable for some, but it's is very much.
But it's satirical.
Yeah.
And this is it. You know, it isn't condoning anything. The satire is against the nature of how these sort of shows are presented, not about what the subject matter is.
I mean, all the writers on board, Charlie Brooker, Graham Lyon, Peter Bainham, you know, there were some big names there early on in their careers, writing some amazing stuff.
Probably did Armando write
it? I think Armando Iannucci did write parts for it as well. And I keep going back to the paedophile episode, just purely for the fact that it amazes me. That episode came off the back of the fact that there was a news story that was going around at the time. There was a paediatrician who some people in their local her local area had found out she was a paediatrician sprayed pedo on her on the front of her house. So this episode was really just kind of showing the damage that the news, you know, can do
and the general stupidity indeed.
I'm going to finish up on this because I could probably run a whole episode on Brass Eye, but I will finish up by saying my favourite Brass Eye related thing is the fact that during the time that it received these 3,000 complaints, the Daily Star ran a big hate campaign against it on this particular episode. They were just lavishing it with hatred and just saying how terrible it was and it shouldn't be on the TV. Do you know what was on the opposite page to that report?
Page 3, a topless woman.
No, it was even better. It was a picture of Charlotte Church on her 15th birthday saying she's all grown up now, and the headline saying, looking chest swell.
Yeah. Oh my god.
The fucking Daily Star.
What is wrong with the world?
How could they not have even realised? But anyway, yeah, Brass Eye.
Irony.
You can pick it up for probably, you know, under a tenner, I'd imagine, on DVD. It's not something you need on Blu-ray, really.
No.
But yeah, it's well worth a watch. Absolutely. If you've never seen it. Please enjoy.
Right, instead of a main topic, we're going to be having the Peanut Gallery, which is going to be a semi-regular feature we have whenever the two of us go and see a film. We're going to discuss it. For this episode, We both went to see the film Chappie, but we went separately, so neither of us knows what the other one thought of it.
Mainly because I can't bear going to the cinema with Graham. No, this is true. That's an absolute lie.
I eat popcorn very loudly.
He does, and he keeps touching my knee.
Yes. So, Scott, what did you think?
I absolutely adored Chappie. I thought, I don't know whether it's because I'm just a fan of Mr. Blomkamp. I just really, really loved it. I like the character Chappie. I like the setting. I think South Africa is ripe at the moment to have more films set there. It's got such a great look about the place, you know, mm-hmm. almost apocalyptic. Albeit this is set, you know, in the future. Main thing for me though was the inclusion of two really larger than life characters, Ninja and Yolandi, mm-hmm. from the South African rap rave group. They is the most Zef de Antwerp.
Who are actually called Ninja and Yolandi.
They are actually playing themselves, yes. isn't it? The whole premise of the, you know, spoilers obviously, guys. The whole premise is that Ninja and Yolandi have bottomed out of the music industry. They've failed. They've had to become criminals.
Yes.
This is never really expressly explained in the film, but that is kind of the intention.
The assumption is made, yes.
They're just amazing to watch.
Now, we should point out that Chappie tells the story of a futuristic South Africa where crime has risen to such a level that in a Robocop-esque manner the South African authorities have actually instituted a program whereby the city of Johannesburg is policed entirely by robots.
They are indeed the lovely Tetraval Scouts.
That's right. So the film starts by showing a raid by these robot police, and we see how efficient they are in dealing with crime. And the idea is that this corporation is manufacturing this robot police force.
You've hit the nail on the head right from the start of what you said there. It is, as people may have seen me put up on our Facebook page, this is Robocop meets Short Circuit.
It is.
There is no way that you cannot compare this to Robocop.
No.
And you do get movies that...
Even to the extent that Hugh Jackman's robot does very much look like the...
Ed 209. He does very much resemble Ed 209. I think it's called Moose, his one, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
The comparisons to Robocop are obviously going to be made. You know, you've got the big company. In Robocop, it was Omnicorp. In this, it's Tetraval.
Yeah.
You've got the evil worker who's obviously in this Hugh Jackman
previously. Which surprised me. I didn't realise Hugh Jackman was going to be the bad guy.
Great to see him as a villain.
He made a great villain. He was fantastic.
Rocking the mullet, yeah. and just a great, great villain. And a real good chance for him to use his own accent for a change. It's nice to hear him speaking in his mother tongue, if you like. I just cannot lavish enough praise on it. I just think it was a great, great movie. I mean, before we go too far, did you like it? Did you like the movie?
I can honestly say...
I'm genuinely nervous about this.
That Chappie, and you aren't going to expect this at all, Chappie was one of the saddest films I've seen in a long, long time.
Isn't it?
It was genuinely heartbreaking. Now, only after I watched it did I go online, because what I like to do is when I see a film, I like to stay away from as much of the reviews and the online reaction as possible so I can form my own opinion. And I was surprised at how negative some of the response was.
It has been slated.
I really liked it. It was a film that had great heart. And what we should point out is, obviously, Scott's touched on the Robocop aspect. And then you've got the Short Circuit aspect, which is the storyline carried by Dev Patel, who is the creator, or one of the creators, of the robot police. And what he's managed to do is create a consciousness, an online consciousness, so that if this is put inside a robot, the robot can think, learn, develop, create, and
paint, write poetry,
absolutely,
you know, just do everything,
as he says. And the head of the company is quite brilliantly played by Sigourney Weaver.
Yeah.
And when he tries to sell her on this concept, she says, "Can I just stop you there? You're trying to sell poetry and painting to the head of a company that builds robots for war."
Yeah.
And tells him not to do it.
Not going to fly, is it?
Absolutely.
Not going to fly.
What you then get is this same robot keeps getting damaged and then gets, in a way, fatally damaged, whereby it's blown up by a rocket launcher.
An RPG, yeah. Yes. But fired at him by Ninja. So yes. Ninja does inadvertently create Chappie.
Yes. And so its battery is welded into it, so when the battery runs out, the robot will be decommissioned.
Yeah.
So they sent it to be scrapped, but Dev Patel thinks, right, okay, if this thing's going to be scrapped anyway, I'll take it and use it as my guinea pig and see if this consciousness will work.
Because obviously Sigourney Weaver's character will not allow him to literally run this very small test to see if this new software that he's written will work.
Indeed. So he runs this software in this robot, and Chappie is born.
And Chappie is basically a child, isn't he?
Yes.
I mean, bar none, for me, in a film of this type, his initial birth, if you like, that birth scene where he is hiding under the desk and, you know, Dev Patel's character is explaining he doesn't understand English, he doesn't know anything. And just the moment when he teaches him about, you know, what a watch is. And,
yeah. But, of course, what happens is that Ninja and Yolandi, along with...
America is the other character.
They owe 20 million...
20 million rand.
Rand to this sort of uber criminal called...
Who's not a very nice man. I believe his name's Pitbull, isn't it? Something along those lines.
And he decides that it's sort of almost off the cuff that they owe him this money due to...
Due to a job that's gone wrong.
Yeah,
I mean,
failed job.
Yeah.
And he just plucks this figure of 20 million and they realise they need to do a big job, but they're not going to be able to pull this job with this robot police force out there. So what they think is... Why don't we try and get a remote control that can switch off the robots?
Yep, that's Yolandi's idea.
Yes, and of course the way they're going to do that is to go after one of the creators of the robots. So they go after Dev Patel. And Dev Patel is literally just leaving work with this decommissioned robot in the back when they kidnap him. And so they are there when Chappie is switched on for the first time with his consciousness.
It's a brilliant wrong place, wrong time kind of story.
And it is literally this childlike creature in this huge robot body.
Yeah.
Quite brilliantly played by...
Sholto Copley.
Absolutely. And I didn't realise that until the credits went up.
Did you not know that?
No. I hadn't picked up on the voice and realised that it must have been a motion capture setup, but hadn't realised that it was him.
Yeah, he is
District 9 and the A-Team.
Yes, and Elysium as well. Mm. Blomkamp's second movie. He's the mocap, and it's really good as well. I love the fact that...
The mocap.
That's what it's called, dude. It's what it's called. Okay, the motion capture in the film is really good.
Back and to the left.
The motion capture is really good. Sholto Copley made a point of wearing kind of like almost like a breastplate and shoulder guards in order for that scene where he's hiding under the desk. Mm-hmm. The reason he was wearing the stuff is so he would know how much space that, you know, where Chappie could fit and where he could be around. And I think that shows very much so in some of the little tender moments when Yolandi's put her hand on his shoulder and things like that. It's just given these actors a good placement to where they can be around him in the mocap, as it were.
Effectively, you've got this childlike robot or childlike killing machine. Yeah. It's suddenly with these people and they're trying to be very gentle and sort of, you know, coercive.
Well, Yolandi is.
And Yolandi refers to herself as his mummy.
Yeah.
She says, come on, come to mummy. Yeah. And therefore, from then on, Yolandi is Chappie's mummy.
Yeah.
And it is just amazing to see this performance whereby... As Chappie goes on, he starts to develop and learn, but feel emotion and feel fear.
Yeah. He's not necessarily developing and learning how maybe Dion, Dev Patel's character, would like him to, because you see that moment, don't you, with Dev Patel where he's looking online about baby's first words and what they're going to learn, and then it cuts to the scene of Yolandi and Ninja being very gangster.
Yes, because what Yolandi, Ninja and America have suddenly realised is they have a police robot that they can teach to do whatever they want him to do rather than what he was initially programmed to do, and certainly what Dev Patel wanted him to do. One thing Dev Patel has said to Chappie is, promise me you will not break the law, you will not do bad things, and Chappie promised him. And so when Ninja says, right, we want you to do such and such, Chappie's telling him no.
And no, I can't shoot people. Chappie, no crimes.
Exactly. And this is why I felt it was so heartbreaking and such a sad film was the scene where they say to Chappie, right, well, you have to learn a lesson about how hard life is.
Yeah.
And they take him out and they drop him in the middle of this gangland in their van and they just drive off and leave him there.
Yeah.
And of course, all the gangsters are there and they're terrified because they think, oh my God, this police robot's just shown up. And then Chappie's going up to them and asking what's going on, and they suddenly realise that this isn't a normal police robot, and they just start attacking him.
Yeah.
And Chappie doesn't understand.
He's just saying, why you do that?
Yes, yeah. He said, why you hurt Chappie? What? And it was heartbreaking. It was like, okay, I know it's in the body of a robot, but it was like a gang of villains attacking a child.
Yeah.
Certainly a child.
That's very much what it is, isn't it?
He was terrified, and it was heartbreaking. And it's crazy because this is a futuristic science fiction film. And that moment was one of the saddest things, genuinely, I've seen in a film for a long, long time.
And it's doing it again,
a great, great bit of cinema.
Yeah, it's doing again what Neill Blomkamp has proved he can do very well from the start. And he does show that whole, almost race issue and people attacking people for being different, you know, as he showed in District 9 with the brawns.
Yeah.
It's notable to say that Chappie was around a long time before District 9 ever came to fruition. I mean, it was one of his short stories.
Of course it was, yes.
And also as well, you know, Tetraval, the company that makes Chappie, does show up in District 9. That's where Vickers goes to pick up certain bits and bobs throughout the film. Again, I can't say it enough. It's just an amazingly good film. It deserves much more praise than it's getting, and I can't quite understand why critics are slaying it as badly as they are. I mean, is it the fact that it's been reviewed by people who don't necessarily understand it? I mean, is it the fact that people are down on South African filmmakers? I don't know what it is.
From what I understand, and certainly from the reviews that I read after having seen it, you've got quotes such as, Chappie boasts more of the big ideas and visual panache that director Neill Blomkamp has become known for, and sadly more of the narrative shortcomings. So I think people are saying that visually he's very good, but in terms of weaving a cohesive, believable story.
I would say to those people go back and watch it again.
But it fell short. And I just think, you know, what is your expectation from this? You know, in terms of, as you were selling it as, a Robocop meets Short Circuit. It ticks every box. Yeah. It had heart.
With a slight smattering of Lawn Mower Man as well,
And again, I know that we've probably spoilt an awful lot thus far, but you know, we aren't going to go too far into the end.
No, certainly not going to discuss the end.
But the bit of the ending, you know, the very, very end of the film, was very emotional. And, you know, yes, maybe some of the plot points were a little too convenient in various places, but this is the story of a childlike character developing within a very grown-up and violent environment.
It's a coming-of-age story.
Absolutely. And in terms of that, I thought it was fantastic. Yeah, now, one thing that I did want to say was Blomkamp famously sort of broke big with District 9.
Yeah.
And then was sort of pulled away from South Africa towards Hollywood, you know, to do the Elysium film.
Yeah.
And has now gone back to South African filmmaking, and a film that is far closer related to District 9 than Elysium. Do we know if that's because Elysium wasn't the hit that people maybe expected it to be, and he's had to go off and do his own thing again?
I don't think that's necessarily the case. I mean, I think maybe he'd had this film in mind probably for a long while and just felt now was the time to do it. It's a brave move for a director who's done a Hollywood esque movie like Elysium to go back to almost patchy roots on your third movie, but I don't think it's going to harm his career, and I don't think any of the reviews that are out there that are maybe not as praising of this particular outing are ever going to harm anything he does in the future. I just think people don't really, and this is going to sound really pretentious, but I don't think people necessarily understand what he's trying to do, and that is to tell very, very almost wholesome stories. Mm-hmm. I mean, and you know, you're saying about this is very much watching a child grow, the story, a coming of age,
develop.
There's the fabulous moments, you know, for instance, at the beginning when you realise that he is very childlike, and then about halfway through the movie, there's a moment with Dev Patel's character talking to Chappie, and he's stood outside, leant up against the wall with one leg cocked up, and he's turned teenager,
yes,
and it's brilliant to see that,
yeah.
As to whether or not he felt Elysium was not as successful as District 9, I'm not 100% sure. I liked Elysium. I mean, Charlton Copley is also in that. A lot of the team that were on District 9 and Chappie are in Elysium. It's a different story.
It is, yeah.
I feel he works better in these smaller stories, though, mm. in the realms of Chappie and in the realms of District 9, you know, because as small as the stories are, there's such a grand scope to them.
Yep.
Just for me, some standout moments in Chappie were Ninja America and Chappie going out to do the carjackings were brilliant, with him explaining to Chappie that they're all daddy's cars.
Yes.
And Chappie smashing the cars up, which was amazingly good, but... As you pointed out very early on, Sharlto Copley voiced and did the motion capture on the character. His voice works brilliant, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah.
It's believable. It's believable as a child, and very much so in the scene that you mentioned after he's been attacked by
the gang.
The gang, yeah. If you like, when he comes back and he's speaking to Yolandi, and it's just, you know, the almost broken English of what he's saying, because yeah. he's so upset. And
yes,
to see a robot right. upset.
Yeah, but
it's quite a jarring thing.
But because he doesn't understand what happened, he didn't understand yeah. why these people who he just wanted help from didn't like him and attacked him in yeah. such a violent way.
Well, he says, doesn't he? Yolandi says to him, you know, did you know these men? And he says, no. And there were children also. And they threw fire, even though I said please. And it was that moment I just went, oh, fucking hell, this is too much.
Absolutely. It's a very emotional film.
Yeah. I think it might have overtaken E.T. now for me, being one of those movies that I think I'll probably cry at again. Because I did have a little tear.
I did too. I'm not ashamed of a bit. No. There was a couple of tears shed in the course of that. And, yeah. I mean, hats off, as we said, to Hugh Jackman for playing a fantastic villain.
Brilliant villain. And why he doesn't do it more, I don't know.
Really getting a good comeuppance at the end, yeah. But
now I forgive you.
Yes, and I Sigourney Weaver as well. I thought yeah. absolutely nailed it as the hard-assed owner of the company, the
Tetravel CEO. Yeah, she was a nasty piece of work.
Absolutely, yes.
But on the whole, I'd happily give it. You know, I don't think I can ever give a film 10 out of 10, but this gets a solid 9.5 out of 10 for me. It's a great movie. Yeah. It's a great, great movie.
For me, I would say a really good 8 out of 10. I don't tend to go halves, but yeah, you know, something would have to be exceptional to be a 10. You know, it wasn't quite up there with the best of the 9s, but yeah, just a very clever bit of filmmaking, really enjoyable, good performances across the board, lovely little story, great CGI in terms of creating this this robot, and due to his childlike qualities, making you care for him.
There's two brilliant lines which I think are in the trailer, which pretty much sum it up. And there's a psychologist speaking in the trailer who just says people are always fearful of something they don't understand.
Yeah.
And maybe that's where the reviewers are at. And Dev Patel's line to Chappie, really, for me, sums up the entire movie. Don't let people take away your potential, Chappie.
Yeah. Very good. So, yeah, that's Chappie. Check it out for yourselves and let us know what you think. But I think that's all for this episode. So from myself, Graham.
And myself, Chappie. Goodbye.
Thanks very much for listening, and we'll see you next time.